Welcome to the broadcast tonight. Jim Hoagland, the columnist for the Washington Post, on the militarization of American foreign policy.
President Bush clearly begins to think about his opportunity to remake the international system, to remake the world in some real sense. But if you use only military power, you cannot really sustain that for very long in the face of the kind of opposition that will mount. You also need a significant diplomatic program, a grand strategy, like a containment strategy that was adopted after World War II to deal with the Soviet Union. That so far is lacking, and that's where Mr. Bush, Secretary of State Colin Powell, and all the other members of his national security team have to work harder.
Also tonight, director Ang Lee, whose movie Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragons won lots of fans, the new one, Hulk.
So I have to demonstrate how it was done. Eventually, I just Hulk out and I do the performances and look at myself, like, is that myself? And start to criticize about it and direct him like a director. And gradually we bring him to life. You know, him being big and green, there's never real reality in it. I have to create the whole movie as the Hulk, mm-hmm. as the Hulk experience, as a modern day myth to stretch that belief.
We conclude this evening with Rob Reiner, the director and political activist whose new film is Alex and Emma.
It's about a writer who is writing a novel, and he's taking from his real life, he's investing it in his work, and then his work turns back onto him and informs his real life. And I thought, what a wonderful way to have these two parallel stories going, feeding onto each other. And I thought, wow, this is a very clever way to do a very honest, real romantic comedy.
Jim Hoagland, Ang Lee, and Rob Reiner coming up.
Coca-Cola and our local bottlers have sponsored more than 4,000 scholars, like Matthew Turner, helping them to attend college and prepare for careers that benefit all of us. Satisfying a thirst for achievement, the Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
The war with Iraq may be over, but challenges for U.S. foreign policy are large. America's credibility in the world depends on its ability to simultaneously handle the transformation of Iraq, Afghanistan, and the Middle East. In the Middle East, Israeli soldiers clash today with Jewish settlers in the West Bank trying to prevent a settlement from being dismantled. The United States also must address the challenge of rebuilding the transatlantic alliance. And finally, there are the threats at home. Attorney General John Ashcroft announced today that an Ohio truck driver pleaded guilty to charges that he was plotting with al-Qaeda to bomb the Brooklyn Bridge in New York City. Joining me now to talk about some of these issues is Jim Hoagland. He is, as you know, a foreign policy columnist for the Washington Post, and I am always pleased to have him on this broadcast. Welcome.
Charlie, how are you?
You just got back. You probably suffered from a little bit jet lag, and I want to talk about the transatlantic alliance, but let me just begin with today's column. Quote, the Bush administration's war on terrorism has led to significant militarization of U.S. foreign policy that has become the dominant force in world affairs. Is that good or bad?
Well, it's understandable in the sense that the president has declared war on global terrorism, and we are involved in a very different kind of war. So naturally, the military is going to be very important. The second point to think about is that the United States has a military power unlike that any history has ever seen. And President Bush clearly begins to think about his opportunity to remake the international system, to remake the world in some real sense. But if you use only military power, you cannot really sustain that for very long in the face of the kind of opposition that will mount. You also need a significant diplomatic program, a grand strategy, like a containment strategy that was adopted after World War II to deal with the Soviet Union. That so far is lacking, and that's where Mr. Bush, Secretary of State Colin Powell, and all the other members of his national security team have to work harder.
First of all, there has to be a recognition on their part that there is no grand strategy. Is that recognition there?
I think in parts of the administration it is. The real problem is, do you have the instruments to carry out a grand strategy once you design it? And that's where the administration needs to do a lot more, I think. We've seen in the last few weeks Condoleezza Rice, the national security advisor to President Bush, take on some interesting operational roles. She's now co-coordinator with Colin Powell in the Middle East, of the Middle East peace process. She's also taken over a special role with Russia. There's now a direct communication channel between the Kremlin and the White House, between President Putin's national security people and Condoleezza Rice and her aides. This is a new development that President Putin kind of let slip out of the bag during the St. Petersburg meeting. So you see more and more operational roles assigned to the National Security Council, which suggests that there is a vacuum in policy. You also see on the other end of the spectrum...
Okay, go ahead, sorry.
Yeah, well, there's a vacuum in the diplomatic part that, on the one hand, Condoleezza Rice is filling, and on the other, Don Rumsfeld, the very active Secretary of Defense, who has control of this enormous, powerful machine, he is also getting very deep into foreign policy, much deeper than any Secretary of Defense that I can think of has ever been. And so you wonder exactly where the State Department is in this mix. Where is the diplomatic strategy to complement and indeed to guide the military power that we have and we've demonstrated?
A couple of questions jump out. First of all, is this simply because of the times? After 9/11, we had the imperative of responding to an attack on our shores from a terrorist organization. That was a military imperative. And therefore, once you began that in Afghanistan, it led to other things.
Absolutely. It's a natural response to an attack on the United States. We've now reached the point, though, where we've had very quick, successful wars in Afghanistan and in Iraq. And in both places, we have continuing political limbo. You need to show that you have a political program to, once you've accomplished your military goals, to entrench them and to see that they can be sustained, and then to come along behind them and put into place a civilian order that is also sustainable.
Why hasn't the Secretary of State and the State Department come forward with a kind of grand strategy as it has in the past with George Marshall or Dean Acheson or others?
I think the first big problem that has to be addressed, Charlie, is that the Secretary of State has made it clear in public on several occasions that he doesn't agree with the President's overall foreign policy. So it's very hard for him to implement a policy that with which he has significant differences on North Korea, for example. He was very late to come aboard the Iraq war option. And on other things, he has not been in sync with the President. That's the first problem. The second problem is that while he is a man of great charisma, great integrity and character, Colin Powell has not shown a strategic vision in foreign policy yet. Maybe that's because he's hemmed in by Rumsfeld, Vice President Cheney, and most of all by President Bush, but it also may be that he's a very good military man who thinks in military terms and in tactical terms.
It is said that the President seeks out the opinions of Donald Rumsfeld and that it's a struggle for the Secretary of State to get his ideas to the President. I can't imagine that that's true, but I hear it said occasionally.
Well, it's striking that you've seen the Secretary of State bring in foreign leaders into the negotiating process, Middle East, the roadmap process being the clearest example right now, where he has really fought to get the European Union, Russia, and the United Nations, Secretary General Kofi Annan, none of whom essentially agree with U.S. policy on the Middle East, to get them into the process, to get his views heard in the White House. So I think there is some truth to the point that whoever you've been talking to is making.
Is it, how will it sit with, you just returned from Europe, how will it sit with heads of state and foreign ministers in other places in the world if their perception is Donald Rumsfeld is creating American foreign policy?
It's been interesting to see the evolution of thinking in Europe. European leaders were very much in Powell's corner, were hoping that he would prevail, were banking on him. They now have come, by and large, to the conclusion that he does not make the case for them anymore in an effective way. They're not very receptive to Rumsfeld's ideas, that is, traditional American allies in what Rumsfeld calls old Europe. But Rumsfeld has some fans among other leaders in Europe, particularly in Central and Eastern Europe, the new members of NATO in Spain and, of course, in Britain.
What is Rumsfeld's policy? What is the foreign policy that he has?
I think it's a very clear, lucid, and hard line on foreign policy to try to keep America predominant in foreign affairs, to eliminate risk wherever possible, and to say to countries, in a sense, you are either with us or against us. You have to help us in the war on terrorism. You have to show us that you're interested in constructing an effective NATO. And if you're not interested in that, we're not interested in you.
Here is what else you said. Classical diplomacy and meaningful international negotiations have virtually disappeared as agents of global change and leadership.
It's something that I think is a dangerous trend. I quote in that article Secretary General Kofi Annan, a very good man in a very difficult job, is asked about the Middle East peace process, and his answer is, we need, as the first interim and urgent step, an armed force, an interim peacekeeping force of soldiers. Around the world today, power and change comes from the barrel of a gun. We need to broaden that. We need to come in with programs that other countries can sign on to in a peaceful way and in a diplomatic way. And we're falling down there.
Listen, you know the community of foreign policy people. You are part of that community. You have a voice that you express primarily in your column. Is there no one in and out of government articulating a grand strategy for America that is opposite the strategy that we saw in Afghanistan and in Iraq?
Well,
I'm
not sure.
Has at its base diplomacy and kind of a grand geopolitical idea?
Charlie, I'm not sure I would say that we need that as an alternative to military force. We need it to complement, to guide the necessary military campaigns that we've undertaken in the war on terrorism, in Afghanistan, and in my view, in Iraq. It is not that you should always be able to avoid taking military action. In this world, you can't always avoid that. It is that when you do it, you should try to have as many nations as possible subscribe to the basis of that war. We weren't able to achieve that in Iraq. We were, to a large extent, in Afghanistan because of the effect of 9/11. It's not that it's either or. It has to, for successful foreign policy, for successful grand strategy, it has to have both components, and it shouldn't get out of balance.
When you travel outside the borders of the United States, do you find a significant sense that America is on the wrong track or the right track?
Both. I've just come back from 4 days in Paris, where I find, interestingly enough, that the French government, both in private and in its public statements, is working hard to try to repair relations with the United States. That doesn't mean that President Jacques Chirac is going to admit that he was wrong, or change his view that a multipolar world in which American power is diffused and softened would be a better world. But it does mean that I think after having searched his soul about the value of the relationship with the United States and indeed the entire Atlantic Alliance, he sees a need to reach out to the United States. He's doing it quietly and diplomatically, and unfortunately the United States is not reciprocating in the same way. But I do find among intellectuals in France, in Britain even, this fear of a rogue superpower taking over the world. I think it's exaggerated, but it is indeed present in many minds.
Jim Hoagland, thank you so much for coming.
Charlie, thank you.
Good to have you. Today's column in the Washington Post, written by Jim Hoagland. He just returned from Paris. We'll be right back. Director Ang Lee is here, and Director Rob Reiner. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Oscar-winning filmmaker Ang Lee is here. For the past 10 years, he has directed such memorable and diverse movies as Eat, Drink, Man, Woman, Sense and Sensibilities, The Ice Storm, and the groundbreaking Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. His latest film is yet another change of pace. It is The Hulk, based on the popular comic book character. Here is a look at the trailer for the film.
Look at you. Off to college to be a great scientist.
Like your father.
There's something inside you so special. Someday you're gonna share it with the whole world.
Let's hit the gamma radiation.
Countdown started.
Nanomeds released.
I don't understand what I just saw.
It's like the gamma released. Some of them was already there.
My son is unique, and the world will not tolerate his existence.
What did you do to me?
I improved on nature a million times more powerful.
My God. Everything we have to stop his movement.
You will only fuel his rage and make him stronger.
You know I never hurt you.
I'm sending her a surprise visit from some friends of mine.
You pathetic freak.
You're making me angry. I don't think you're gonna like me when I'm angry.
The film opens nationally on June 20th. I am pleased to welcome back to this table Ang Lee. Welcome back.
Thank you.
It's great to see you here.
Great to see you.
Now, why are you... This movie costs more to make than all the movies you've ever done in your life.
10 times more than all of them put together.
So why are you making... We'll talk about it and how good it is, how tough it was to make it and what went into it. But Ang Lee making a comic book character.
I guess I'm reaching my midlife and about.
This is explained by a midlife crisis.
It's about time I touch my alter ego, so to speak.
You want to touch your early self.
I call it my new green destiny, my American hidden dragon.
Yeah.
It's just a very exciting project when I heard it. And when I say it's time, not only I'm prepared for it to rip myself apart, whatever. I was allowed to do a big movie that's personal.
Big movie that's personal. We know what's big about it, which was the budget and the character and
the
huge
summer,
comic
book,
all summer release,
everything.
All that. What's personal about it?
Well, he's the alter ego. He's the subconsciousness, so to speak. It's something very hard to do in a big movie, and that sort of forced me to Hulk out.
To Hulk out.
As a cinema person, as a human being. Because there's probably not such a thing. It's very unsettling. It's enigmatic. And of course, it's big and green. And how do you stress the audience beliefs so they also can invest the real emotion, which I usually do. That's what I do. How can I stretch that range as a filmmaker? That's personal. And subconsciousness and doesn't have a logic. And I have to allow that to happen. On the same time, I'm a big boy now. I have to deliver a summer movie. It has to play a certain pattern.
It was time for Ang Lee to make a summer movie.
Yeah, but in my kind of way. Yeah. Personal also means that I want to attend every little detail, like how I used to make movies.
You sort of anticipated the question I was going to ask you. Tell me how this is an Ang Lee movie. What is it about? How would I recognize
the psychodrama? It's about repression and release of repression, acceleration. That's not new to me. I do it from first movie on to Sense and Sensibility to basically repression. You have to come to terms with people. You have to close yourself up. You have to deny your really urge and need. Mm-hmm. And in the meantime, you have that primal impulse, the life forces, the Hulk in you, the alter ego that keep us alive, energetic, and that has a lot of aggression in it, and frightful in the same time. So that's something I always deal with, except in a more civilized, minor manner. Yeah. But I always love to do drama, Western drama, and put my two cents of yin and yang and a Chinese point of view into it, just naturally. And I'm a forever film student. I like to explore different ways and means of making movies and learn how people do this and that. That's all very attractive to me.
What was the biggest challenge of this?
Bring Hulk alive.
To make him what? Make him
human? Humanized.
Humanized. Yeah. In other words, create somebody that somebody
could identify with as a human being.
Who's as big and large and as powerful and as invulnerable as he was.
Yeah. That's the hardest thing for animator to do, to bring continuity and the performance.
And how did you do that? By what?
I did it myself. Yeah. It turns out that I have to show them how to do it. First facially, then I put on a suit.
Yeah.
And perform.
Oh, you put on a suit?
Yeah, I'm the Hulk.
You are?
Yeah. Well, Bruce Banner is the Hulk. Yeah, Eric right. Banner plays
the one who's
take 10 months commitment to build little by little. I have to participate hours a day to make it happen. Make sure the performance is what I meant, what I said. The scenes were already cut it before we even put the Hulk in. So I have to demonstrate how it was done. Eventually, I just Hulk out and I do the performances and look at myself, like, is that myself? And start to criticize about it and direct him like a director. And gradually, we bring him to life. You know, him being big and green, there's never real reality in it. I have to create the whole movie as the Hulk, as the Hulk experience, as a modern day myth. To stretch that belief.
Why is he green?
I was green in the comic book. As a matter of fact, the first issue was he was in gray. He was a nocturnal creature. It's like Wolfman. It's not even rage that bring him to be the Hulk. Then gray was not very friendly with printing art back then, so they make him green. Mm. It happens to be my new green destiny.
What's the scientific basis behind the creation of the Hulk?
In the book, it was just the gamma radiation.
Then
he changed. To me, it takes more because I invite the audience to invest real emotions. And movie being photography, I have to bring certain realism. So the scientist has to talk like scientist. So I sort of made up some pseudoscience and have a science advisor that made them science right. We brought in, and actually, at first, Jim's idea. The writer's idea to bring in nanotechnology. We have to update what was cool back then in the 60s, which is nuclear test, gamma bomb, Cold War era, bring that anxiety and technology to the days. And after all, it's really Frankenstein. Genetic engineering, and then the traumatic experience, and the rage is unbottled, effort of covering it, and then
take a look at this. This is a clip. This is where Talbot, played by John Lucas, and Bruce, played by Eric Banner, they meet for the first time. Here it is.
You and I have never had the chance to get to know each other properly. Well, it's because I don't want to get to know you properly or improperly. So leave. Hey, no worries. You know, let me give you a little heads up. There's a hair's breadth between friendly offer and hostile takeover. I've done my homework. The work you're doing here is dynamite. Think. GIs embedded with technology that makes them instantly repairable on the battlefield, in our sole possession. That's a hell of a business.
Well, it's not what we're doing here.
We're doing the basic science for everyone. You know, someday I'm going to write a book. I'm going to call it When Stupid Ideals Happen to Smart, Penniless Scientists. In the meantime, Bruce, you will be hearing from me.
The summer movie appeals to all ages?
I hope so.
Yeah.
I do want to show respect to children, like my kids. They saw some of it before the movie was made. And I asked their opinion, and they're saying, like, my 12-year-old saying, like, you have to give more credit to the kids.
Is that what he said?
Yeah. And it was annoying. We've shown to some kids the intensity do draw their attention. I'm not sure about, like, very small kids. Yeah. It might be too intense, it sounds too loud. I hope the movie touches all kinds of inner Hulk people feeling.
The idea of casting, you casted, I mean, the Eric Bana.
I want somebody who's carrying the inner Hulk, unlike a wimp in the comic book, so he can get your attention for 2 hours as a leading man and a fresh face. So Eric is...
You wanted a fresh face.
Fresh face.
Yeah.
Compelling, good-looking, but has that inner Hulk quality.
Now, what do you mean by inner Hulk quality?
Intensity, like Hulk. Yeah. Solo intensity.
Jennifer Connelly.
She is the no-brainer.
That's easy. Like, Beautiful Mind. Like,
It was before Beautiful Mind.
Because she's...
Like everybody,
you saw her before Beautiful Mind.
Before, basically, I know, I follow her work and Record of the Dream. And by that time, she just finished shooting, making Beautiful Mind with the studio. It was no-brainer, it was easy.
Because you wanted her to show what both?
Intelligence
for
beauty,
sure. Beauty,
heart, everything you want
and
from the character.
And captivated by the Hulk.
Yeah, the warmth and, yeah.
All right.
The beauty.
And Nick Nolte.
And Nick
who
Nolte
plays the...
He's a brilliant actor. I love his work. And it's a very messed up, complicated, crazy character who was giving all the Shakespearean
this
lines.
Is the father.
The father.
Right. Who creates the son.
I want an actor that I envision him doing because he's an actor. He can do all this brilliant, crazy stuff. Yet I have sympathy for him and you don't hate him.
So why is that? Because you want to hate him because he's...
Yeah, but I watch Nick Nolte. He's only bring complexity, not hatred. So I thought he would be a perfect person to portray that role.
Roll tape. This is where Nick Nolte tells Betty, Jennifer Connelly, that his son and the one she likes so much is unique.
My father's with the military. He seems to think he's involved in some kind of threat to national security.
Your father, Ross. You brought your father down upon his head. How little you understand, Miss Ross, and how dangerous your ignorance has become.
I'm sorry.
Don't be sorry. My son is unique. That's why you can't relate to him. And because he is unique, the world will not tolerate his existence, will they? But you try, don't you?
What's interesting about this part of it, I mean, is that you're dealing with a comic book character, and yet you have these very real people who are relating to
brilliant
this character.
Actors.
And who are brilliant actors who therefore pull it off. They have
they
enough
have
credibility.
They have something in common, though. They have not only that, but they have something in common that I chose them. I can sense the inner Hulk in them, just on the look, the way they carry the scenes. They has that potential. I think everybody dealing with the Hulk, they're dealing with their own inner demon or monster or something. So I was particularly choosing the cast that you feel the Hulk is everywhere, that intensity they carry, the brilliance they carry, something larger than life.
Some say that he is, that the Hulk is, the most difficult CGI-created character ever made.
I believe so.
Why is it difficult? This is just a big guy.
It wouldn't be as difficult if I don't want the audience, I don't care for audience to associate with human being.
Yeah.
Yeah. Humanize in computer world that I learned, I didn't know. It's good that I'm innocent about the technique before I start out. The hardest thing for them to do is humanize something, let alone pull him green. Because so once he's green, he's not believable as a human being. So how do you make that happen? It's hard for me dramatically. It's far hard for ILM to create him.
Yeah, and they, you know, I'm so proud of them.
So
how did they do it? How did you do it?
Little by little, the movie, the way people look at him, the way he performs, the way his thing, he messed up. He doesn't do the typical cartoon animation kind of acting from one place, one pose to another. He's not animated, he's moving along. It's hard to find a good pose for him. Something I learned from dramatic movies, I have to mess him up. When he runs, he trips, and you know, when he hit the dog, the Hulk dog, he slips, and that's the hardest thing for them to do. He's not working for poses, but he's leaving for motion pictures. That's extremely hard to do. Then when I complain about his reality, island people took the color out, make it black and white. He said, look, he has more detail than an actor. He's more real than an actor. And once you put him green, he's not real. They have to like carefully put in layers and layers of maps of textures and translucencies and have all function and dysfunction in certain ways to bring his life.
And what did the audience testing tell you? I mean, you have to change the ending, you have to do anything. That I can tell you one thing, they did not want him to die. Right?
You might not want to believe this, but the movie was never tested. Nobody's seen it.
Is that right?
Yeah. I made an agreement with the studio. I don't want to test it. Because I know it's not going to be finished when you test it. Yeah. There'll be so many holes, it will be unfair. And then that's add another layer of stress is you don't know what's going to happen.
This is a silly question, but you had Final Cut.
Yeah.
So this is your movie. You made the movie you wanted to make.
Yes. It's not really about studio control.
Yeah.
It's about how do I come to terms with the genre and the public out there. That's the real stress. There's to a point nobody knows what to do with the film. And I have to bring it together with consciousness and... Jim Shem is my friend,
he's a
producer,
writer.
He's a writer. Yeah. Like midpoint, he's telling me something I try to keep myself awake is that he said, you don't have to be responsible, but you have to be reasonable. So the last 3 months.
Reasonable about?
Deliver a big movie, you have to come to terms with the genre, hit the notes.
Right. If you're going to play in the game, you got to play the game.
Yeah. You can bend it, but don't break it. And
congratulations.
Thank
the
you.
Hulk opens nationwide on Friday, June 20th. My pleasure to have Ang Lee here. He doesn't do many of these interviews, and I'm always happy that he includes me on his
Thank you.
Stop.
It's Thank a you. Pleasure. It's an honor.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Rob Reiner joins us. For almost 20 years, he has directed many memorable films. Here's a look at some of his work.
What?
Are you the Miracle Max who worked for the king all those years?
The king's thinking son fired me. And thank you so much for bringing up such a painful subject. While you're at it, why don't you give me a nice paper cut and pour lemon juice on it? We're closed!
What we do is if we need that extra push over the cliff, you know what we do?
Put it up to 11.
11, exactly. One louder.
Why don't you just make 10 louder and make 10 be the top number and make that a little louder?
These go to 11.
I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to a man who rises and sleeps under the blanket of the very freedom that I provide and then questions the manner in which I provide it. I would rather you just said thank you and went on your way. Otherwise, I suggest you pick up a weapon and stand a post. Either way, I don't give a damn what you think you are entitled to.
There is no such thing as an ass. Just like there is no such thing as the perfect marriage, the perfect job, the perfect child. The whole notion of staying together and living happily ever after. All illusions.
So you're saying you don't believe in everlasting love?
You're seeing the ass again, and not the tops of the legs.
Misery Chastain cannot be dead.
Annie, in 1871, women often died in childbirth.
But her spirit is the important thing, and Misery's spirit is still alive.
I don't want her, bitch! I want her! And you murdered her!
Mickey's a mouse, Donald's a duck, Pluto's a dog. What's Goofy? If I can only have one food for the rest of my life, that's easy. Pez. Cherry-flavored Pez. No question about it.
Goofy's a dog. He's definitely a dog.
He can't be a dog. He wears a hat and drives a car.
No, you did not have great sex with Sheldon.
I did, too.
No, you didn't. A Sheldon can do your income taxes. If you need a root canal, Sheldon's your man. But humping and pumping is not Sheldon's strong suit. It's a name. Do it to me, Sheldon. You're an animal, Sheldon. Ride me, big Sheldon. Doesn't work.
Do I date a lot?
Yeah.
No, how about you?
Me? Well, lately I seem to be going out on a lot of first dates.
Well, then you're experienced at this.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you can ask me anything.
Well, how are we doing so far?
It's hard to say at this point. So far, it's just your typical first date stuff.
Damn, and I want to be different from the other guys.
His latest film is a romantic comedy. It is called Alex and Emma, and it stars Luke Wilson and Kate Hudson. It is loosely based on the Dostoevsky novella, The Gambler. Here is the trailer from that film.
You want to dictate an entire book to me in 30 days.
That's right.
Are you out of your mind?
Meet Alex. He writes.
What's your book about?
It's about the powerlessness of being in love. How it devours the inside of a person like a deadly virus.
It's a comedy. Meet Emma. She types.
Ample bosom. In every book I've ever read, whenever there's an ample bosom, there's always heaving.
If you could type and I could write, that'd be really terrific.
You're the one who introduced the bosom. I'm simply asking if you'd like them to heave.
The beauty of writing is you can have things work out the way they never seem to in life.
Ilva will help you get settled in the guest cottage.
Well, here we are.
There are things that I take from real life that work for the story.
So is everything in this book true?
Here we go again.
Would you like some tea?
Have some paella.
Wait a minute. Who's she?
She's an American, and her name's Anna.
Hello, Adam.
You look a little different today. Did you do something to your hair?
This is good. You're creating a triangle. Polina, Adam, Anna.
You can't always control what happens to characters. Sometimes they take you to unexpected places.
From Rob Reiner, the director of When Harry Met Sally.
I don't like tomato skins.
Who are you?
Wilson.
The reader doesn't know who he's gonna wind up with. You hook him in.
Kate Hudson.
She does not love him.
Kate Hudson.
I was just washing my hair.
And Kate Hudson.
Who does he end up with?
See? Hooked. He stood looking into her eyes. Should he kiss her? He knew in his heart he had no choice.
Alex and Emma.
I am pleased to welcome Rob Reiner back to this table. We got a lot to talk about. First of all, are you happiest directing?
In my theatrical life, yes. I would say yes.
You mean something else is more important to you now, which is the whole outside life. You have your involvement in politics and public issues and children.
Yes, and then that ultimately gives me more pleasure. It's interesting as I've gone along, when I started out as an actor and I became a director, people would ask me, what do you like better, acting or directing? And I would say, well, I like directing because it's more involving. It gives me a chance to express more of my talents. And acting is fun. It's like recess.
Right.
Now I look upon directing as recess because that's a fun thing to do. Since the last 4 or 5 years, I've been involved in government in California, and I'm chairing a commission that oversees a $650 million a year program for early childhood development in California. And seeing programs put into place, preschool programs, health care for young children, and child care and parent education, these things, and seeing how it profoundly changes a child's trajectory, whether or not a child is going to be a toxic or non-toxic member of society is in a large part determined by what we do in those early years. To see that gives me tremendous pleasure and tremendous satisfaction. So I've seen that, that's happened with me, and now that I look at directing as, okay, I love doing it, it's a lot of fun, I get a lot of pleasure out of it, but this other thing is much more fulfilling.
I want to come back to this other thing in a few minutes. We'll come back to that. Tell me about Alex and Emma.
Alex and Emma is, I love this movie because I've made a lot of romantic comedies, and they're hard to find. It's hard to find a good original, fresh idea. And when this came to my attention, I thought, wow, what a clever way to tell a romantic comedy story. It's about a writer who is writing a novel, and he's taking from his real life, he's investing it in his work, and then his work turns back onto him and informs his real life. And I thought, what a wonderful way to have these two parallel stories going, feeding onto each other. And it almost was like a magician doing a trick for an audience, explaining the trick as you do the trick, and then hopefully the audience is still amazed by how the trick turns out. Yeah. I said, what a wonderful balancing act to do. And so I thought, wow, this is a very clever way to do a very honest, real romantic comedy.
And Kate Hudson is the new Meg Ryan?
Well,
so to speak.
I think she's the new Kate Hudson. I mean, she is extraordinary. She's, first of all, absolutely adorable. Yeah. I mean, I, when I first met her, I fell instantly and madly in love with her. She is so sweet and so charming.
I start off with being in love with her mother first.
Her mother, yeah, her mother's a terrific lady. Goldie's a great, great lady. But Kate is, she lights up the room. She does all those classic things that you want a movie star to do. She lights up a room. She's charming. She's sexy. She's funny. She's a wonderful actress, both comedically and dramatically. It's almost not fair that somebody
she's
should have
so much
this
stuff.
Much
yeah.
stuff going on.
And Luke Wilson?
Luke Wilson is a throwback for me to like those great, what I call unsweaty actors, like Jimmy Stewart and Joel McRae from the 30s and 40s. And these guys who just are very laid back, very cool, you know, no effort, just things kind of just ease out of them. And yet he's got this weird kind of quirky sense of humor that just kind of infiltrates everything and makes this wonderful persona on screen. And the two of them together, they've got great chemistry.
What's the hardest thing about a romantic comedy after you, let's assume you got the chemistry. Let's assume you got the right. I mean, is this now slam dunk for you?
No, the hardest.
And let me rephrase the question.
Yeah, yeah.
We got script.
Yeah.
We got chemistry.
Yeah, yeah, the script is the toughest part, and then you're 80% home if you get the right script. And to me, the kinds of romantic comedies that I like are reality-based, character-driven romantic comedies. They're not high-concept, screwball-type romantic comedies, although people love those. I'm not particularly drawn to those kinds of romantic comedies. And to me, the hardest thing is to get something that is real, that is reality-based, that shows how men and women really do interact with each other, and then also get laughs. That's the hardest part, to make that balance, and that you hopefully get in the script stage.
We are going to talk about your political involvement. Do you think that you have been distracted from doing your best work? Because sometimes people will compare. You've had such an illustrious career, and they say it's almost like they want to see you top this.
Yeah, yeah.
Has your work suffered because you have matured, you have a successful company, you're involved in everything?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, that's for other people to decide. I do know that it is difficult to balance the work I do, the political and work I do in government, and also the film work, because they are totally contrapuntal. I mean, these are two different mindsets that don't easily blend with each other. So I know that that has been a struggle for me. But what I've tried to do, and at least before I did Alex and Emma, I gave myself essentially a four-year period where I focused on getting the first five program in California up and running. And so that's what I focused on. And then when I did my film, I tried to
now,
focus
why did you come back and do a film? Because the stuff that you're doing outside of your professional life has huge importance.
Yes, it does. I felt comfortable to be able to do a film at this point because I think I had gotten the program onto some fairly firm footing. We are now in all 58 counties in California. We've got a school readiness program set up in all of these counties. We've got over 100 school readiness resource centers set up. We've got universal preschool beginning in Los Angeles County for every four-year-old in Los Angeles County. We've got universal health care coverage in a number of counties. The program is pretty much now up and running, and I felt secure enough to be able to back away a little bit in order to do a film. Now, the next step is to start thinking about how we can use preschool education as a big linchpin for overhauling public education in California. That's the next step. And so I'm going to have to think about what my next step is going to be in terms of my career and in terms of wanting to accomplish that.
And tell me what the options might be.
Well, there's a lot of ways to do it. There are a lot of ways to do it.
I'm cut right to the chase.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's a movie term. There you go. Now we're back to movies.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, people say that Rob Reiner is a logical Democratic nominee for governor.
Right.
In the same breath that they say that Arnold Schwarzenegger is a logical Democratic Republican candidate for governor.
Yeah, the Terminator versus the Meathead.
That's what they say.
Yeah, we've had that.
But you know, politics... That's one of the options, is to seek elective office.
Yeah, that is an option, and that's not something I take lightly because, first of all, I have three young children, and how it would impact them is very important to me. So I have to really think it through in terms of how it would affect their lives. And second is to make sure that I have a real vision of what I want to accomplish and how to accomplish it. It's not something to do for vanity reasons.
Right.
I don't need to be famous. I am famous. And I don't need the ego stroke of doing that. It is purely a function of, do I have a vision? Can I accomplish something? And how to go about doing it? If I feel I can do that and I feel it's not going to negatively impact on my family in any kind of dramatic way, then it's something to consider.
You have a vision. I mean, you know what your politics are.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I asked you who you're supporting for president. You said, without a missing a beat, Howard Dean. Howard Dean, you know where he comes from. He's a progressive left Democrat.
Yeah, Howard Dean, though, if the truth be known about Howard Dean, I think he's the only one that could possibly beat George Bush in 2004. I think he's the only one who can distinguish himself and set himself apart from George Bush because he stands for very, very different things. Now, the truth be told about Howard Dean, he's not a namby-pamby liberal. This is a tough, tough guy.
No,
this is a hardcore fiscal conservative.
Right.
This is not some, tax and spend liberal. Yeah. You know, he's not like
that.
So
we can look at his record in Vermont and say this is
a guy
who did
this. Absolutely. He's balanced 12 budgets in Vermont, and Vermont is one of the, now you can say it's a small state, but then they have a small amount of resources. You still have to balance what the budget of the resources that you have. And, you know, it's one of the few states in this country that's not running a deficit right now. You got, all over the country, the states are running a deficit. And the reason it's not running a deficit is because he has set aside rainy day fund. He has set aside money knowing full well, just like you have to balance your budget, I have to balance my budget. You set aside money for when times get tough. And he did that. And now in Vermont, they don't have to cut any education or health care programs. No social programs are being cut. That, to me, is a responsible, hardcore
fiscal conservative. Here's the issue for him, and I said this to him when he sat in that very chair within this past month. You know, you have this idea, can he win?
Right. And you're going to ask that question until he does, you know. Can he win?
Can he get the nomination?
Get the nomination? That's the key. If he gets the nomination, he has the far greater chance of beating George Bush than any of the other candidates.
Because, to use an old Hackney political expression, you know, it's a difference, not an echo.
Yeah. Here's my dream scenario for how it works. And by the way, you know, I haven't talked to Howard about this, but, you know, you see Wesley Clark.
Dean and Clark together?
That's a great
ticket. That's your ticket?
That's a great ticket because, you know, you got Wesley Clark, who's brilliant. He's Rhodes Scholar, Supreme NATO Commander. Vietnam War. He's been in. And
Kosovo,
he can shore up NATO. The national security part of the ticket. But here's my dream scenario. You've got Iowa. Now, Iowa's up for grabs. You know, the touters that say Dick Gephardt's got a good shot in Iowa, maybe does. But Dean comes in second or a close third in Iowa. He goes to New Hampshire, he wins New Hampshire, which is a distinct possibility. I think he will win New Hampshire. You go to South Carolina.
He's running neck and neck with John.
With John Kerry. And the undecideds are swinging, I think, going to swing to Dean at the end of the day. So he wins that. He goes into South Carolina. In South Carolina, you've got, maybe Edwards does well, maybe Bob Graham does well, and Dean, you know, hangs in there a second or a third and a close there. So out of all of those primaries, by the end of February, you don't have any clear front runner, and Lieberman somewhere in the mix of all of that.
Right.
You go to California in the beginning of March, and this may, because they've moved their primary way up, this may be the first year that California really
has an impact
on who's going to be the nominee.
Generally, it's already been decided.
And if Dean can win California, and I believe he's got the best shot to win California, that's the way he can get the nomination. And then you know, he's tough. He's going to fight hard.
All right, but here is the question. Bill Clinton, who looks at politics with really a smart eye,
yes,
says that any Democratic nominee, nobody's smart about politics.
Yeah. Yeah.
any Democratic nominee has to pass a national security threshold.
That's right.
You don't get a national security threshold by putting Wesley Clark on your ticket, in the same way that George Bush didn't get something by putting Dick Cheney on the ticket. You got to pass it on your own.
Yes, you do. But it helps. I mean, a lot of what the criticism of George Bush was that he was weak on foreign policy, that he didn't remember, he didn't know the name of the president of Pakistan, that crazy thing. Dick Cheney was put there for a reason. And
what was the reason?
Well, to shore up his foreign policy credentials. He had a former Secretary of Defense. There was a lot of discussion of Colin Powell, if you remember, right. Even before there was talk of, you know, maybe Rumsfeld coming back. You got the sense that, you know, the joke was he was surrounding himself with the adults. That's part of an image that you project, and you're right. You have to win it on your own. And by the time it comes down to, the general election campaign, Howard Dean, I guarantee you, will be up and knowledgeable about all of these issues. He's up and knowledgeable now. I mean, he knows more. He's traveled more than you know George Bush
so
has done now.
So you think he's got the right stuff?
I do indeed.
All right. Tell me what all of your work for children has done. How has it made a difference in the life of children?
Well, first of all, you've got children who wouldn't have had health care insurance who have it in California. You had kids who wouldn't have had preschool education who have it. And we now know, based on all the studies that have done, that if a child has preschool, has more likelihood that they're going to have success in school and later on
right,
in life.
Absolutely.
It levels the playing
right,
field,
absolutely.
Especially in California, which is a, you know, in Los Angeles County, 0 to 5, the 60% of the kids are Latino, and a lot of them, the parents don't speak English. So giving them that preschool, that even start, that head start that gets them on a level playing field is critical. We know, based on all of the studies that we've done and the work we've done, that these children are having a chance. They've got a chance now to succeed. Whereas, you know, we see dropout rates, we see kids not going on to college. We know that in places where they've instituted early childhood programs, preschool programs, and healthcare programs, the dropout rates go way down. The college entrance goes way up. And these become productive citizens. We know it.
Your involvement in this grew out of your own children?
No. This came out of my own exploration of my own life and knowing and understanding the basic reality that influences you had early on in your life had a direct and major impact on how you functioned.
So tell me how Carl Reiner influenced your life. Other than the fact that he took you and you could hang around with some of the funniest and smartest people in show business.
That was one good thing.
Yeah, right.
That was one good thing. Well, you know, there are pluses and minuses. You know, I have a good life, and I have great parents, and they've done. You know, I'm functioning. I'm making a living. I'm married. I have three kids.
Right.
But as I went through a difficult period in my life when I got divorced and I was single for 10 years, I went through a very difficult introspective period where I could see. Earliest influences in my life playing themselves out in how I related to colleagues, to friends, to members of the opposite sex. I could see how those things played out, and I wondered, was there anything in that, in what we can be doing to help parents with their children, to giving them a better start in life? I didn't know how it could translate into public policy. It wasn't until later on where I started to gain a little bit of a foothold in terms of a power base and starting to reach out to people and realizing after seeing so many news reports about kids shooting somebody up in a school or in a McDonald's and seeing the same news report over and over where they, you know, people would come on, the teacher or the person from the choir said, oh, he was always a sweet boy, very polite, he never bothered anybody. And I said, there's a disconnect here. Nobody just picks up a gun and starts shooting people unless there's some disconnect somewhere along the line. And then when you research and study back, you see that there's neglect, there's abuse, there's all kinds of dysfunction that led to a child going off, on the wrong course. So I started thinking about it, and I reached out to a lot of people and started putting together the program that we did in California.
It's great to see you. Come back here anytime.
Okay, I will.
And you might be running for governor.
Well, we will have to. The jury is out on this.
Well, the jury is out on Gray Davis too, isn't it?
Well, hopefully he'll weather this storm, because this is not the way to run a democracy. Not the way to
do it. And this democracy out there is what, the sixth largest economy in the world?
Well, it's the sixth largest economy in the world. The idea that somebody, you know, with 15% or 20% of the vote could then be the governor of California is not, to me, the way to...
And if it comes down to that, name recognition and Schwarzenegger will be...
It means a lot, yeah.
Arnold the governor.
Well, we'll see. We'll see.
It's great to see you.
Okay.
Thank you for joining us. See you next time.
Coca-Cola and our local bottlers have sponsored more than 4,000 scholars, like Matthew Turner, helping them to attend college and prepare for careers that benefit all of us. Satisfying a thirst for achievement, the Coca-Cola Company.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, actor Harrison Ford, his new movie is called Hollywood Homicide. Also, a conversation about spam. Next week, Annie Lennox. Join us.